Claire from his position as a counselor in the Eau Claire school system. And I think, I have to say, from what I observed, he spends a lot of time at Beaver Creek now. He's been volunteering there for a really long time. He's done a lot of talks around the area, so I snuck on the internet and read up about some of his activities. He's been a licensed bird bander for 15 years. And that's a presentation I enjoyed Larry talking about at Beaver Creek. It was really fun. We got to actually watch the birds and see some birds get banded. He says he's been involved in bird feeding forever, so that's good news for us who wish to learn more about it. Other hobbies include nature photography and yard work. He told me that's way down on the list. We're very happy to welcome him here to share his knowledge with us today.
Thank you, Larry. I normally do not use a microphone, but sometimes, particularly when talking to seniors, they're getting like I am. Need I say more? I always have said that after 34 years of middle school and junior high kids, you really don't need a microphone. You get accustomed to speaking loud. So she's somebody's going to kind of adjust the sound back there. If I get too wound up, she's going to turn me off completely. If it isn't loud enough, she'll turn it up a little bit. But I enjoy coming here. And there are one or two of you who are here just checking to see if I say the same thing twice because they've already heard me. And I told Ron, I said, I don't know what I'm going to talk about yet. So did you remember what I talked about a few weeks ago? That's good. It's very informal, people. Don't hesitate to ask questions. If we don't get through everything we're supposed to get through by 5 o'clock, isn't that true? We'll cover what we can in that period of time. But as Marty said, I've been involved with birds for a long time. I've been involved with Beaver Creek for a long time. Some of you may have heard a couple of quotes before, but I appreciate these quotes. One of them, first one, and I use this one primarily for one major reason. When I go into a grade school setting now, kids look at my equipment and say, what is that? It's a slide projector. What are slides? I am not into all of the modern, fancy, technical presentations. It'd be nice if it were, but you're going to look at those 35 millimeter slides today. But I like this quote for one reason. In a world that seems so very puzzling, is it any wonder birds have such appeal? Birds are perhaps the most eloquent expression of reality. Henry David Thoreau. Kids today have difficulty connecting with reality, I think. And that's why I'm so happy to be involved with Beaver Creek Reserve, where I can get kids this size out releasing a chickadee that they've just watched us put a band on and heard us talk about, or other things that are in the outdoors. And I think we need that type of connection to get kids back to the world of reality and get them away from all the things plugged into their ears and all the things that they're doing and so on and so forth. Now I'm preaching on what. The other one, I'm sorry, that was Roger Turkeys that said that. I got an older quote. I sat in my sunny doorway from sunrise till noon, wrapped in reverie, amidst the pines and hickories and sumacs, in undisturbed solitude, while birds sang around or flitted noiselessly through my house. That was Henry David Thoreau. I don't know what kind of house he had, but it must have been interesting if he had birds flitting through it. But can you picture it? Can you join in with that? If you are, how many of you are bird watchers? Okay. How many of you are bird feeders? Okay, about the same number. If there's someone that didn't raise their hand, I say, why did you come to hear about bird feeding and bird watching? It's the fastest growing outdoor activity in the United States. I was trying to find the latest statistics, and I could not update from 2007. But in 2007, there were over 55 million people involved in this activity. Now, spend over $3 billion a year on bird tuition. That was 5 years ago. And if you know what the price of bird seed is today, it's probably over that $3 billion mark. An additional $800 million is spent on bird feeders. And bird watchers contributed to the U.S. economy in the year 2007 an estimated $36 billion. Between feeders, feeding, traveling, binoculars, and all these, $36 billion. So it is a pretty good outdoor activity, and economically is very good. Now, why do we do this? Why do you bird watch? Why do you feed birds? You want to volunteer?
Relax. The beauty and have something to do.
Beauty and have something to do?
It's relaxing.
It's relaxing.
But the bird is out there by itself, and how the bird can take care of itself, and all we can do is watch. I mean, it's just, it's a blast.
So what I'm hearing come through in all of these responses is, we feed birds for our benefit, right? We're not feeding birds for their benefit. Birds got along long before we ever made a bird feeder. Birds got along long before we ever started putting out bird feed. And you know what? If we quit bird feeding, birds would get along without us. That makes us feel useless, doesn't it? But we do it for our benefit. Now, in extreme weather conditions, yeah, that's a little different. But birds do not become dependent upon us. So I get that question all the time. I can't go on vacation because I got these birds coming in. Birds will do just fine without you. You go to Florida for 3 months in the winter and they'll do just fine without you. Now I do recommend that if you're heavily feeding, that you taper back. Don't just, we'll leave them tomorrow morning and pull them all the feeders in. Give them a chance to find the neighbors better food anyway. Right? But birds will get along just fine whether we have our feeders out there or not. So it's really for our benefit. It's our relaxation. People ask me, doesn't that cost you an awful lot? How much is that relaxation? How much is that watching the beauty of birds? What's that worth? You know, my wife thinks sometimes the bird food bill is higher than our food for the house. But then I remind her, if you add in all the times we eat out, it balances out. But yes, it is costly, but there are some ways that I think we can economize with it also. We derive pleasure as far as birds are concerned. When should we feed? How many of you feed only in the winter? How many of you feed only in the summer? How many of you feed year-round? Good. They're, to me, not because they are dependent upon it, but a lot of people pull in their feeders at the end of the winter saying, well, they can go on their own now. To me, one of the joys is watching the birds in the summertime bring their young. I've lived down on South Michigan Street in Shawtown for well over 30 years. And I've been feeding birds all the time since we started down there. So I have several generations, I think, of birds that have returned and returned and returned. Some that stay around all the time. How many of you keep records of your yard? Interesting. I don't see a hand.
Good intentions.
Good intentions. Never have produced a record. 1987, I started keeping records. Now, I'm not a record per se keeper, but I simply had a notepad on the counter. And every week, starting like last Sunday morning through this Saturday, for this week, I write down every type of bird I see in my yard. Now, big deal. But when you go back to 1987, that's 25 years I've been keeping records. I record the first time I see a red-winged blackbird in the spring. The first time I see any other returning birds. So I can open up my three-ring notebook and I can follow from 87 through 2011 and tell you when the first cowbird showed up, when the first redwing showed up. And it's amazing when you look at that, how close they are to returning. And if one species is late in coming, basically all of them are. And it's just, to me, it's just kind of a fascinating thing as to how many species of birds you also get in your yard. Now, I consider my yard, where I live, my lot, anything that flies over, and anything that comes to the Chippewa River, because I'm right on the Chippewa River. So that is what I'm considering my area. In those 25 years, I have recorded 126 different species of birds.
Really?
In Shawtown. 126 different species. To me, it's kind of an interesting statistic. Last summer, I had 20 species of young birds come to the field. 20 different species of birds. Now, you don't have to be an expert identifier of birds to do that sort of thing. I'm going to show you some slides here at the end of the day of the most common birds and what we have coming in. But you don't have to be an expert as far as identifying that many birds. To me, it's fascinating to watch a young woodpecker come in and try to figure out how to get suet out of the feeder. You know, they're pretty clumsy until mom shows them how a few times, particularly the big pileated, or the downies, or the hairies, or the red bellies. Just watching these young birds come in. Now, what do we need to draw in 126 species? Now, I haven't had 126 sit in my tree at my feeder. That means the tundra swans have flown over. The bald eagle that sits in my front yard regularly, which is kind of neat. And some of the waterfowl species, the only waterfowl species I've ever had in my yard, is a hen mallard who hatched out 11 babies in the yard and took them down my driveway and down to the river. But I do see others, common mergansers were on the river yesterday. The mallards are there and so on. So what does it take? Four things that you gotta have. The same requirements that you and I have. We gotta have food, we gotta have water, we gotta have protection, and they need a place to raise their young. It's that simple. Now, depending on what type of yard you have, will determine how you fulfill all of those four needs. And I want to address each of those needs today as we look at it. And I think I'm gonna leave food to the last, because if you see, I've got a few things to talk about and show you as far as food is concerned. But let's go to water. How many of you provide water for your birds? How many of you provide water in the winter for your birds? How many of you provide moving water for your birds? Less and less number of hands. And I'm just offering some suggestions. Water in the wintertime for birds is probably more important than the food. Where are they going to get water? You get a cold, cold winter. Where are they going to get water?
Like you, I live on the Chippewa, and I don't worry about the water so much. Is that right or wrong thinking?
Chickadee's going to have a hard time getting water out of the Chippewa River. Most birds are going to have a hard time getting water out of a big body of water like that. How are they going to bathe? You say, well, it's too cold to bathe. No. Birds will bathe year-round. They know whether it's too cold or not. A dirty bird is a dead bird. So, consequently, we really need water out where it's very easily accessible for them. Yes, sir?
I have two electric bird waters. You cannot believe how they take a bath every morning.
Yep.
The water just flies.
Yep. Yep.
Temperature don't mean a thing.
Doesn't mean a thing to them. Now, if I would offer one suggestion, we'll talk about bird bath that I've got here. If it gets extremely cold, put some thin rocks in there and have your water only so deep to keep them from really submersing and getting in. But watch when water melts, ice melts in the driveway. Look out and see how often birds come to that puddle in the driveway in the middle of the winter or when the sun has started melting water. Water is extremely important. If you are not providing water, I would urge you to provide water. Particularly, obviously, during the summer months, they have a little more access. But in the winter months, birds come into that. Oftentimes, birds will come into my bird bath, my heated bird bath, before they go to the food in the morning. They need the moisture. So water is extremely important. I don't mean heated water, but the type of bird bath we have, which is thermostatically controlled, will just keep it from freezing. Now, granted, they can eat snow. And you will see birds picking at snow if there's no water available. So would you like to get a long drink eating snow? The lift up. So the water is of utmost importance, and particularly there are all kinds of heated baths or heaters you can put in it and so on. I mentioned also, as far as water is concerned, the movement of water, bubblers. Any of you have bubblers in your bird bath? That attracts them. I'm going to show you a couple of slides. I've got one rock, imitation rock bubbler. So one of my chickens thinks it's his own private jacuzzi. He gets right down there, and that's a water bubble over him. And where do you get these? Well, I just happened to be looking at the magazine. I don't know what I did in the magazine. Here it is. One I got the other day from somebody getting receipt catalogs, and this was whatever this one was. They got an interesting one. I'm going to order one. It's a little artificial rock. It has a little electric pump in it, like you have for statuary type things, and it just bubbles water over. I have one already, but I'm going to get another one for the other heated bird bath. Kind of an interesting idea. But the movement of water is very attractive to bringing in birds. In the summertime, if you got a mister, watch a hummingbird take a shower in your mister, where it's shooting out a fine mist. Or your sprinkler. You ever seen a hummingbird do that, the sprinkler? They'll hover right over it and just, that's how they get their bath. If you have a way of building a waterfall type thing, any type of movement, sound of water is extremely attractive as far as birds are concerned. So any one of these types of things. You don't want a deep bird bath. You don't want one of these that are this deep. This one here, matter of fact, I just bought it last week and I don't have it up yet. This is another heated bird bath. Notice it's pretty shallow. And even though it is the depth that you see here, I still put some flat rocks in here because you only want half, three quarters of an inch of water. That's plenty. So I put some rock in here and I'll put that bubbler in here and birds will flock to this water. But you do want it so it's relatively shallow. This one has a nice rough surface. Some of these real, little more cheap models are very slippery. There's nothing for them to grab onto. A lot of times I'll put fine rock in here or gravel, if nothing else, so that they have shallow water, but they have pretty good footing as far as the water is concerned. And this one just hooks into an electric outlet. Thermostatically controlled. It's awful expensive. No, we did a study one year out of Beaver Creek, and for pennies a day you can run one of these. So it really is a good investment as far as water is concerned.
There's a question?
Yes, you bet.
Where would be the best place to put that? Like under a covered porch by the house? Or you don't want snow and all the stuff falling on it, do you?
Your best place to put a bird bath is the same thing as the best place to put a feeder, where you can see it. Where you can see it. You can put it on the deck. This one actually attaches to a deck. I'm going to put it on a 2x4 because in the back of my yard, I have a place where I have an outlet and I can plug it in right there. The other one I have right out my kitchen window on a 4x4 post where I have electricity run out to it where I can see it. And that's so true with whether it's water or feed. Your purpose of doing it is for your enjoyment, right? So if it's for your enjoyment, you want to be where you can see it. The other thing you want is where it's easily accessible. When snow gets this deep, you know, well, there's my feeders out there. As soon as the snow's down, I'm going to go fill them. You want them accessible to sight and accessible physically to get to them. Bird baths need to be washed periodically, obviously. A light solution of bleach and water, scrub them out, put them back out, let them dry, air dry good, put them back out, fill them with water. Yes?
You bought the cord. Can you use an extension or?
You can use, matter of fact, this one recommends a certain cord, which is waterproof.
Uh-huh.
I'm fortunate I had an electrician, not me, I had an electrician run underground water to my post. I have an outlet right there, and the cord hangs there, and I plug it into the post. Uh-huh. A lot of people, how many of you have them on decks? Water on decks? Just run your cord out there?
Yep.
And you can get pretty good cords, which keep out the moisture.
Well, on a deck, they have to be concerned about the floor of the deck, like a carpet. Outdoor carpet, wouldn't it be?
Wouldn't it? Just on the deck railing. This one attaches right to the deck railing.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
Where you can see it, it's easily accessible. Matter of fact, this one even tips, or you tip to clean it, or it slips right off. Yeah. Yes?
My husband has two retrievers. What are my chances of being able to do anything in the backyard?
Well, probably relatively slim with retrievers out there running. Yeah. Yeah. Again, if you got it high enough off the ground where they couldn't jump up on it, you don't want them tipping one of these off. And particularly some of these feeders or some of these bird baths are pretty expensive. Mm-hmm. I don't buy that. As you find, as I talk today, I'm relatively, as the Scots would say, financially astute. Not cheap. But yeah, it depends on the situation.
You have to try it and we'll find you out then instead of the
I would.
The
bank
is fenced in and they can.
Oh, jump. Sure. Sure. But again, where it's accessible to your sight. It's no fun feeding birds if you can't see what you're doing.
Wherever you feed your birds, keep your water close to where you feed.
Yep, it'll draw them. Yep. The other thing that I read this when I put an in-ground bird bath in. Cut a short stick or a branch, and obviously you couldn't now in this weather, but birds coming from a tree to a bird bath don't like to come directly from the tree and land on the bird bath. You want a stick in the ground that's kind of up over with little branches, invariably they will come, they will light on that branch and then drop them down to the water. So you want just not sticking a bird bath out in the middle of a 3-acre field because they're not going to come. They're going to want something to come to land on, to look over the water. They're very suspicious at first. I rarely ever see a bird fly directly to my bird bath. They always come to that branch that I have stuck in the ground up over.
Does the weed or water attract deer?
I think anything attracts deer. Yeah.
That's the only reason I don't have a bird.
Okay. Yeah, they will. They'll break out of it. Again, they're creatures that need moisture. Sure. Yes.
What about squirrels?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. My squirrel runs up the branch, takes a drink, jumps back up. Yeah, no problem. No problem. He's up there regularly. Other questions? Yeah, Mom?
After the bird has bathed, it's also such that he'll fly back to that perch or whatever and kind of fluff in the right branch
up. Fluff up, pick, preen, you bet. You bet. Yeah. Okay. Water. Takes care of that. We talked about shelter. I'm sure you gardeners know a lot more about best shrubs for your yard and so on. But they do need some shelter, whether it's a certain kind of shrub, trees, evergreens, arborvitae, whatever, the shelter. And as far as nesting purposes, that's another whole area. Robins like platforms, as far as nesting is concerned, but they will also obviously go into trees. I have one that always builds a nest on my yard light on the back of the garage. She's raised several broods back there, and that's fine. It makes a nest in the garage, but that's okay. We're past the season now. If you go by my yard right now, and Marty mentioned one of the last things I do is yard work, you'll notice that. I've got 3 or 4 Christmas trees in the backyard, or in the side yard. And what I do is, what the world is this? This is a miniature. In the fall, I'll put this out, not this one. I made it just to show. Piece of plywood, depending on what size, prop it up so the birds have something to feed under. I throw feed in underneath this. And then put Christmas trees around it. Now, it may not look the best, but it's for the birds. And the reason I do the Christmas tree is protection. Because anytime you're feeding birds, you're more than likely going to draw in a Cooper's or a sharp-shin hawk. And obviously, why should they go out and try to find a bird someplace else when they got a whole smorgasbord right there at your feeder? I have actually seen Coopers come in, and you'll know when your birds see a Cooper's or a Sharpie coming over, because they'll either freeze tight and not move. I watched a white breasted the other day for 5 minutes, he never moved. I never saw a hawk, but I'm sure there was one someplace around. Because he was just like he was a frozen statue on the feeder. And once danger passed, then he went about his business. But if the Cooper's or the Sharpie comes in, you'll see your birds fly. If you've got a pile of Christmas trees around here, they just bury themselves in there. I've literally have seen the Cooper's go around and flop with his hit his wings on the tree trying to flush them out. So it is a form of protection as far as the birds are concerned. Okay? So whatever type of protection, shelter, you have those things as far as their nesting is concerned, so a place to raise their young. Now, let's go back to the food. What are the best types of food? If I can only have one kind of food, I'm sure we will probably can pass these around. Now, one type of food, black oil sunflower. If I could only do one thing, this is what it would be. Black oil, a couple reasons. One is, it is smaller, so your pinches have an easy time cracking it open. Number two, the food content in the black oil is so much higher. Oil content is so much more nutritious for birds than the striped seeds. The striped seeds are bigger. They're harder for small birds to open. And I said I'm somewhat financially astute. They're more expensive. If that could be possible, black oil went up this year. But black oil would be probably my number one choice as far as food is concerned. Now we can pass these around. I'm sure most of you have an idea what that is. The second one that I really like, and I use a lot of, probably less this winter, if I cut back, I have about 25 or 30 feeders out, so you can see the food bill does run up a little bit. But that is the hearts of this black oil, the sunflower chips. Okay, the sunflower chips. Now, more expensive. But if I buy a pound of sunflower chips, how much food do I have?
100%.
A pound. If I buy a pound of black oil, how much food do I have? If I buy a pound of this and they're not live on the ground, how much do I have to rake up? Nothing, because the ground feeders clean it up for them. They shell out 100 pounds of black oil, I got 100 or 20 pounds of husks to rake up. And by the way, if you rake that up, you probably most of you may know this being gardeners, don't throw it in your compost pile. There's a chemical reaction there that will kill anything. So don't throw your rake, when you rake up your sunflower, dispose of them in the garden. Or some other disposable way, not in your compost pile or anything. Look under your feeders and see how much is growing there. If you've got black oil holes there. So I've heard of people, compost pile doesn't do anything. Well, I dump all my sunflower chip seeds in there. No, not the best thing. Chips come in three forms, or three sizes. Fine, medium, large, or coarse. Personally, I always get the fine. The reason being, most of my feeding of birds with chips are your finches, your chickadees, your small birds. Now, if you have the coarse, which is the largest, which are almost full-size hulls, chickadee reaches in, takes one out, crunches down, three-fourths of it is gone. He reaches in and takes one little one, and it's just a matter of much easier as far as birds are concerned. So chips. Plus, generally, sunflower chips run a little cheaper, the fine, than they do the medium coarse. I don't know why that is, but that's my choice as far as the chips are concerned. Oh, one I do not have luck with, and maybe I have not given it enough time, is safflower. I talked to other people who, they didn't have safflower, they wouldn't have a cardinal come to their feeders. I have a hard time getting anything to come to safflower. And as I say, maybe partly my attitude. I've not used it long enough, and consistent enough. Some people like the safflower because squirrels supposedly don't play it. supposedly don't like it. I have yet to see something the squirrels won't eat. Or find a way to try to get to it. But the safflower is a villain, and cardinals particular. Yes, sir?
I have a roof, 16 by 16. I've got 40 bird feeders underneath. I cut my feed in half by putting a roof over all of them, which everybody can't do that. They don't have the area. But I went to pan feeding instead of hanging feeders because them little finches and the winter birds, they'll sit on that perch and they'll pick that out until that feeder is empty. My pans are 12 inches in diameter, 2 inches deep.
Okay, interesting.
And I've saved an awful lot of food by going to pan feeding.
Very good.
So if you got some old kitchen utensils that your wife don't want no more,
good idea.
Put a couple inches of bird seed in there and set it out.
The thing is, I would think the key is to keep it covered. Otherwise,
yeah, I don't get no snow in mine or nothing. It's all under snow and rain.
Yeah, you got to start over. Interesting.
And then I got it all planted with arborvitaes around there, so they got coverage. And I've been feeding them for 25 years.
Good. Where are you? I'd like to see that stuff.
Tower Drive, 4292.
Oh, my old country. I live in Seymour.
Oh, yeah?
McKinley Road.
Oh, okay.
McKinley School. Okay.
I lived there where I'm at 53 years. Oh, my
God. Then you have a steady clientele of birds.
I've fed for 25.
Good. Good. Thank you for that suggestion. Any other thought? Okay, let's try something else. Thistle. How many feet is the thistle seed? Okay. Good for finches. And again, I have gone away from it. My birds seem to go to the chips and the black oil more than they have the thistle right now. I'm thinking of getting back into it, but right now I do not have any feeders as far as thistle seed is concerned. Millet. Now, I really don't put millet in a feeder as such. This is my ground feed for my morning doves or the other ground feeders, if you have any winter sparrows or anything like this. Just plain white millet. Okay? A few years ago, my wife and I and another couple went to England, Scotland, and Iceland. And we stayed in working farm bed and breakfast. And every place that we stayed that had feeders had peanuts off to the birds. And I hadn't thought that much about it. I knew we had them, but I just had never gotten into it. But peanuts for birds is an excellent attractant, particularly to the pit mice, to the woodpeckers, the blue jays. Now, some of you may not like blue jays. I personally think they're one of our most beautiful birds and one of the most intelligent birds. But each to our own opinion on them. So I got a peanut feeder, put peanuts in, and the tit mice are there all the time. Before I left, there was a pair of tit mice there working on the peanuts. So again, these are not your salted peanuts or your Planters peanuts. You go to the seed store, feed store, buy peanut hulls, okay? Corn, I don't use shelled corn. But I do put out ear corn. And on my feeders, I have, as I said, there's 25, 30 feeders out, but I've got 3 4x4 posts with cross arms on them. And on those cross arms, I can put a number of feeders. I can put as many as 8 feeders plus a fly through on top on each of them. But then I have screws or nails off the arm going up, and I just stick ears of corn on there. Particularly for the blue jays. The blue jays really enjoy it. So again, it's a corn, I guess we don't. But I do use ear corn simply for the blue jays. You say, well, how do you keep the squirrels away? Well, first of all, if you ever find a squirrel-proof feeder for sale, don't buy it. If that's your sole reason for buying it. Because there's yet short period of time, there's not a feeder around yet that the squirrels are not going to figure out eventually, including the weighted ones, where I've seen a squirrel on a weighted one, get one squirrel and get on this side and hold it open while the squirrel on the other side is eating. You know, it just, it's embarrassing as a bird feeder, bird watcher, to be outsmarted by squirrels all the time. But I did find one book that had one solution, definite solution to squirrel problems. In one line, 16-gauge shotgun. Yes, sir.
I took a bicycle wheel, and I put four bolts, and I sharpened the end of the bolts. I got this wheel on an axle so it spins. I got four cobs of corn on it, top, two sides. You ought to see them squirrels get on that, and they'll jump up on that, and they'll just hang right on, and that old wheel will just turn and turn.
Yeah, they will do that. The other one that's fun to watch, and I have done that, is take a cord or a long cord, hang it from a tree, and then take a long spring, attach the spring to that, and then attach an ear of corn to that. And then I had it out from the tree. I built a little platform so the squirrel would get on there, and then he'd jump. You know, just like a bungee, you know. And they will, they'll still get on it, but at least it's fun to watch them to do that sort of thing, is to watch them on that bungee cord.
Yeah.
Yeah, right?
I told my brother, who lives in California, that I was having trouble with squirrels coming in all the time, and I've never seen one around here, but he sent me a spinner, and at that time we had a deck that was 10 feet above the ground, so I, and the feeder, if you can imagine, is about a little bigger than a softball, maybe a little smaller than a volleyball, and it's about so long, you can put quite a bit of feed in it. At the base of it, it's got a little wire bar, and the birds fly in, sit on this bar, and feed and feed and feed. And I had it out where, just off the deck railing, and the squirrel would sit on the deck railing, and the minute he put his front feet on that spinner, it kicks in with a battery, and away he goes. And you know, it doesn't hurt him at all, but it gives him a ride. Maybe 10 feet above ground.
Yeah, I've heard that battery forward, but matter of fact, someone told me the other day when we were talking at some place, one of the presentations, someone said they had one of those. And that squirrel got on there and wouldn't let go, and he kept spinning. Wouldn't let go. The guy finally went up close enough, he jumped off, and he got on the ground. Boom, boom, boom. He was so wound up, and totally lost his equilibrium. So yeah, they can be entertaining. You know, if you can keep them from eating all of your seed, they can be entertaining.
One of the ways to deter a squirrel, I had a feeder in the yard on a conduit, and it was on a flat piece of wood, and the feeder was up here, and I put a piece of soap paper on, and he'd run up, and he'd stay there for a few minutes, and down, and he'd sit there and look up at it, and he'd go back up till he got in that stovepipe. He couldn't figure it out, and he never, no, went in.
No, if you get big enough stovepipe, that's what I have on all my 4x4 feeders, are stovepipes. Yeah. The thing is, it doesn't do anything for chipmunks, because they go right up the inside.
Yeah, but so if you got this wooden...
On the top, you put a platform across.
You got a platform on top.
Yep. I plugged one, too, and the chipmunk chewed through it. So there's always, you know, something as far as the squirrels are concerned. Okay. Three other kinds. And these are all mixtures. I'll send the new millet mixer on first. Not bad. This one's got black oil, little chips, some peanuts, but they also put some grain in it. But there's no millet in here. Now, the millet or the milo, this stuff here, wild bird seed number 2, it says. You can buy, you know, 50 pounds for $1.50. Not quite, but you might as well waste pour your money into the Chippewa River. This kind of stuff with that red millet or the red myall is worthless for up here. For most birds, I've got to adjust my statement because I always said that. It's a southwestern bird feed. The red, some of the doves and so forth of the southwest will eat that. But if you look around, this is what's underneath, and this is what most of your cheap bird seed is filled with, because it's a cheap filler. This is why it can be sold for the price that it is. But I have to make an amendment to that whole thing, because my nephew heard me say that once, and he said, I have proof that some of our birds eat that red stuff. So he sent me a photo from the Indians of Falkirk. Indigo bunny chowing down on this red stuff right now. He said, that's the only thing my indigo bunny will come into. I can pull all kinds of seed out, but if I put that red millet or red myall, sure enough, there are those pictures of the indigo bunnies eating it. So I have to make one addition, you know. If you have indigo bunnies, it seemed to work for him, draw it in. But otherwise, no, that's the cheaper one. This one is a mixture of black oil, chips, and so on. If you want to make your own mixture, buy what you want to feed. Mix it yourself. Then you don't have to have the cereal grains in it. You don't have to have the cracked corn in it, which is good if you like house grills. But I've had people, you know, mix their finch mix, which is simply chips, fine chips, and thistle seed. Or you can mix your own, pick what you want, and mix it that way. It's going to be cheaper in the long run, and you're going to get what your birds are going to eat. And here was the Nobel Prize. Okay. Any question on or any idea on the foods? Yes, sir.
I inherited a bucket of, I should say a bucket of shell corn. Because it was given to me to antagonize my squirrels, and I have not got the proper feed drawer. You know, can I take and smash that shell corn with a hammer and put it in a container and feed some birds with it, or am I just going to get the sparrows you're talking about?
You're going to get rough birds.
Okay.
All sparrows. Morning doves may pick at it, but they prefer the millet also.
Okay.
But your other birds basically are going to shy away from it. Other question or other comment? Yes, way in the back.
About sweet feeders.
Yes.
I've always put out a sweet feeder.
The suet. Yeah, I'm going to come to the suet.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, right. You got. Thank you.
Where do you get your bird seed?
Well, I'm not here to do a commercial, but I will say where I get mine. And that's elk hung seed. The guys there know their bird seed. They know their stuff. As a matter of fact, all these feeders are elk hung seed. They gave them to me several months ago and said, keep them as long as you need them for all your programs. What I do have up here, they have a mailing list. And they send out their special sheets monthly. To anyone on their mailing list, and so I said to Mike when I was over there today, I said, he's got little elk hound seed, you put your name and address on your phone number, and they will put you on their mailing list, and even do your email if you want. So if you're interested in that, I'll send a couple of these around and put your name on it, just leave them right on the pad, and I'll turn them into Mike. And you can get on their mailing list for their specials. And their specials are only to their mailing list people, generally. Or if you remember the Beaver Creek Bird Club. She said I could push Beaver Creek every once in a while. But they will I'll serve these in for you. And Mike will put you on his mailing list. And it's not a solicitor's mail list. It's simply mailing out their weekly or their monthly flyer so that you have an idea of what is going on as far as specials to their special list. But that's where I get it. But like I said, if someone runs a real special, I'm not devoted to one place. The amount of feed that I give, the thing is with elk hound, we gas is not the time to drive over there and back. If someone is very close in price in town here, and some are running. Some are running some specials. You just kind of have to shop around. Okay?
Yeah.
Is there a truth that
if
you feed the squirrel, like if they have their own corn or the middle area, they'll leave your feeders alone. Is that just...
I've never had that luck. But maybe someone else has. She has a question or the comment, but if you put your... have a place to feed squirrels, that doesn't draw them away from your bird feeders. Ron?
That's what I did, because in all the bird books I've bought, line number 6 or number 7, if you can't keep the damn things away, give them their own feeders. You put a feeder off 40, 50 feet away. Well, I built myself my own corn cob feeder. It's 4 foot off the ground. He's got to crawl out on the stick. And, of course, after they ate a cob or two, I don't know if they got tired or what, but now the blue jays are eating my corn cobs.
Which is squirrel food.
And the squirrels are not bothering me. So
so it does work.
It can work. It'll take pressure off your feeders.
You take that cob corn when you're feeding that, you'll get a lot of flying squirrels at night. And if you don't know whether you got flying squirrels or not,
you'll just
put a little floodlight out there on that cob of corn, because they only feed at night.
And they do the same on my suet.
Yeah.
But I like flying squirrels. They're better than the gray squirrels. Now, the gentleman reminded me that I didn't mention suet, and that is, to me, that's one of the big draws as far as particularly the woodpeckers. What kind of suet? You can buy the suet plus. There are all kinds of block suet. A lot of it is loaded with grains, cereal grains. If I use this kind of suet, I get the peanut blend. Particularly, I like the peanut blend. But I can put out one of these, and I can put out a feeder with this in it. They will not look at this until this is gone. Now, what is this? This is beef kidney suet.
Oh, really?
You only can find it at slaughter, where they're actually custom butchering beef, like Gunderson's in Mongolia. I've got another little place down at Durand. And what it is a white suet that encases a kidney. So when they butcher the animal, they take the kidney out, and these places that actually have this for sale will split it open, take most of the kidney out, so you get the pure white suet. Now I'll turn this around so you can see what it feels like. By far, my birds go to this. I was just down and bought about 70 pounds of it the other day. It comes in chunks of anywhere from, depending on the size kidney that she saves for me, anywhere from 10 to 12 to 15 pounds in a chunk. Now, here it comes with this ugly piece of suet that is frozen. I let it soften just enough so I can slice it like that, put it back in the freezer, and you're all set. It's pure suet. It's by far the best I've found as far as my birds are concerned.
What about venison suet?
Excellent. Venison suet, they will go for that also. What you don't want to put out, call it suet, is trimming like a T-bone steak.
Really?
That isn't what it is.
The fat around the
bone? Oh, yeah. I've got some people who, once they are done butchering their venison, hang the whole carcass up. Now, that's not the most pleasant sight, and I don't know if my neighbors down in South Michigan will like that, but I know people living out in the country, they'll take their whole carcass and hang it out away. And in a matter of time, that is down to nothing but pure bone. And chickadees actually use the cavity at night if they're, as a shelter place. So it's not the most pleasant or agreeable thing, but it is something that people do use. And kidney, venison, suet, excellent. Birds love it. Now, the commercially prepared suet is fine, it'll work, but as I say, I go with, it's a peanut blend. It's the one I like the best. You can get it with all the other stuff. You can get blueberry, you can get orange, you can get, I guess, cranberry, grape, and everything else. I've never tried that, because most of those birds don't eat suet anyway that they're aiming it for. So you've kind of got to fit the margins of what you've got. Another one that I use, I have it, here's a little bag. Well, who took it? This little bag of, it's actually peanut butter mixture. And what it does, goes in, and I shouldn't be starting to talk about some feeders. It goes in this type of a thing, real expensive feeder. You got a branch you cut off both ends, put a panier on it, drill a few holes off your table, or your drill press. And what I pack, you can pack suet in here, you know, like this suet, soften it up a little bit, pack this suet in there. But I make a mixture, or my wife makes a mixture with her big mixture, which is cornmeal, white flour, shortening, peanut butter. Okay? Cornmeal, and yellow cornmeal, white flour, shortening, peanut butter. Those four mixtures. Kind of in the ratio of 3 or 4 to 1. 3 or 4 cornmeal to 1 flour to 1 peanut butter. And you put it in there and you mix it. If it gets too gooey, if your peanut butter is too oily, put a little more cornmeal in it. If it's too dry and it's crumbly, put a little more peanut butter in it. Pack it in here and bird flow. Yes?
Larry, would you just repeat that ratio?
Sure, if I can remember. Yellow cornmeal, white flour, shortening, peanut butter.
What's the ratio?
Oh, basically 4 to 1 to 1 to 1. 4 yellow cornmeal, 1 of each of the others.
Okay.
Some people throw, makes a difference, you've been on with that. Some people put in some chips, some people will throw raisins in, some people will throw nut meats in, some people will throw chunks of cranberry in. You can mix whatever you want in. I don't. I use them strictly that kind of a mixture and just pack it into this type of a feed. Crisco, yeah. Peanut butter, the cheapest you got. Yellow cornmeal, white flour. And you want it so it isn't oily, gooey. Now, some people use straight peanut butter. Number one, peanut butter prices are up. There's a financially astute again. But the other thing is, it's not the best for birds to have that pure peanut butter as far as, you know, the stickiness of it and so on. But suet is an attractant. If you have any woodpeckers around at all, they will hang on that. I looked out the other day and I had 5 downies, a hairy, a red-bellied, and a affiliated, all of the suet. I mean, of course, I've got 7 suet feeders, I think.
Do you get into a mesh or
a suet? I personally don't like the mesh bags, simply because the feet get tangled in.
How about the metal?
Well, here, let me tell you. These are the ones. Now, here's your suit, basic metal feet. And you can hang them. They come with hangers, as a matter of fact. I threw every hanger away that I ever got with one of them. I don't like the hangers, and I'll tell you why. Just take and attach it to a piece of wood.
Yep.
Okay, the reason being, if you know the physiological structure of a woodpecker, what's his tail? Extremely what?
Long.
Small and stiff. So he comes in and like, whoop.
Oh.
Right? Whereas if you got this, he's got a tail prop.
Remember, I was at your first meeting over to the senior center. I was so damn tickled you sharing that. I went home and did that, and I should have called you because the next morning when I put the dang feeder out, it was night and day.
Yeah.
Night and day.
It's just so much easier because of the physiological structure of a woodpecker. And so, you know, all you do is take this thing and put a couple of screws or a couple of washers. If you want to make a double one, you put one on the other side, you're all set. Yes, sir?
If anybody wants to feed any suet, if you go down to the Augusta Meat Market,
okay,
he'll give you all the suet you want for the birds, free of charge.
Well, that's a better of a deal than I got at Duran. I think, yeah, that's good.
I get a lot of it from him.
Very good, good. And that's the beef kidney suet. Yeah. Yeah, now this one, now, you say, what about the great big one? I had a couple of affiliateds coming in. Have you ever watched affiliated try to get on one like this? So, I make a little bigger one for the affiliate. And you can put a couple, fill it up, and the affiliate is loved. Now, yeah, Beth?
Larry, we had a affiliate there, and he was so cute. He was up here on this top feeder, you know, on the station. He was sitting up there, and he was looking down at the suet feeder. So pretty soon, here he is up there with his head way down like this.
Well, they're funny. You ever watch them out on a winter shrubbery that has berries on it? Philly that lands on top and goes all the way down, he's eating upside down off the berries. Yeah, there it is. Did you just put that back there? There's that peanut butter stuff. Make sure. Okay. This is kind of a neat little feeder. Pursue it also. Now, again, you can buy the rings that go on here for about $4 a piece. Or you can take one of these others, and then I take a drill a hole in it, and slip it down over the top. Or I put my beef kidney suit on. Really, this is kind of a neat one. Inexpensive. I've got this one hanging, one like this, hanging near my 4x4 post. And it's interesting because if the pileated comes to that back, or the front yard 4x4, he can land on the 4x4 and reach over and eat off there. He doesn't have to worry about his tail prop or anything else. He's all set. This is kind of an interesting little one. It's one I just ran across. This one? Menards. Yep. Yep, that one is Menards. Okay, did we cover food and water? I know one thing I didn't talk about. And I have not tried this. I can vouch for people who have. Mealworms? Mealworms? How many of you use mealworms? Have you used them? You get bluebirds coming to these, and they'll wait for you to throw out their mealworms. Mealworms. Yeah, it's what we used to call, I remember years ago, some of you ice fishermen many years ago, we had California grubs. I think it's the same thing. We call them California grubs, and we use them for ice fishing. Now they're dried mealworms.
I have a feeder that I made just the purpose for the bluebirds, and I fill it with mealworms.
Yeah. They love them. Have you tried the dried?
No.
Well, I've talked to some people. You can raise your own mealworms if you don't mind having a lot of worms in your house. I mean, I've talked to some people whose wives were not real happy when they were raising mealworms. But, of course, my wife isn't happy with $90 in the refrigerator either during fishing season. But these are interesting. These are reconstituted dried mealworms. Guess where they're made? Who else but the Chinese would make manufactured mealworms? Yep, that's where they're from. But we have, you can buy at the pet food store if you want to get the live ones. These are better. These are relatively inexpensive. It's about $3 for this thing. That's $1,500 or $1,500 or something. But it's worth, I have not tried them. I cannot vouch, but I do know people who have. You mentioned the bluebird feeders. Now this is a pretty expensive one. It's not one I would buy. This is for sale out of Beaver Creek Reserve. But it put your mealworms in there.
Yeah.
Go inside, bluebirds can go in, or whatever bird, other birds that like a mealworm. Now for $52 you can have this one. Out of Beaver Creek. It's a lot of recycled material, but again, I think there's things that
I got one just like it that I made.
It didn't cost you $52. Right, there's so many things I think that you can do. But this is a typical mealworm feeder. Now, this would also work. This one cost me some scrap lumber, a plastic cup, and a little bit of rope. Same thing. I mean, it does the same thing. Actually, what this one is for summer feeding my Orioles.
Orioles, yeah.
This one, fill it with jelly. If you want, you can put a couple of dowels here and put an orange on each end.
Yeah.
And but these I have hanging around strictly for my Orioles.
How does that little thing I see it, the whole. Yep. How do you keep the honeybees out?
You don't.
Or the ants, or, I mean, there's always.
Ants you can do, honeybees you can't. Other than, the best thing for bees, what I have found is Avon Skin So Soft. The liquid Avon Skin So Soft. What I do with my, particularly with the, oil for a hummingbird feeder, take a little bit on your finger and just put it around the hole. And it won't affect the birds, but just a little bit there generally will be a deterrent to the bees. That's the best thing I've found.
Well, Avon Skin So Soft. People use that Skin So Soft for children to keep mosquitoes away from you.
But it works for bees on your feeder.
Okay.
As far as ants?
Controlling them?
Right there? There? Hanging on your feeder? Fill it with water. Ant comes down, it's gonna hold. Can't cross it. Plus the chickadees use it, drink of it. Now, you can buy one of these for $4.95 or $5.95 or wherever they are. Or, you can do like I did yesterday. Save the cap off your laundry detergent. Buy a turnbuckle. One washer. Drill a hole in that. Take it apart, put it through. A little bit of super glue. You got one of these. Little less than $5. And they work just as fine. Plus, you can have more colorful ones. You got a nice orange one. Fill it with water, it's all set. So, turnbuckle, 74 cents. Okay, works. They work just fine. Okay. Any comment or question on that? What time am I supposed to be done?
5 o'clock.
5 o'clock, here we go. Very quickly. I got an hour of slides available tomorrow. There's another type of oriole feeder. By the way, orioles love your grape jelly. There's another type. I like this one. This one I use because you can also put a little jelly on it. There's a spot here where you can put jelly and also get your liquid. Okay? You do not need to put color in your hummingbird stuff. There's quite a bit of question off. I happened to find an article the other day. Is red dye harmful to hummingbirds? There's no argument about it. It is. You read what the scientists have come up with. And the amount of red dye that a hummingbird would ingest would totally change the genetics as far as the bird is concerned. I'm not going to take time to talk about all these different feeders, but there's all kinds of hummingbird feeders, orange, a feeder of the orange as far as the orioles are concerned. There's a little window feeder for juice. Here's one that works kind of neat for put jelly in there, put an orange up here, you're all set. And actually, this is made by just for the birds. It's a developmentally disabled group. Kids that make these. And that's over at Health on Scene. Okay, enough there. Types of feeders. I don't know how much time we want to spend looking at feeders. This is one of my favorite styles. I don't know why. It's just chickadees love this one. Now, I don't have the two deck. Mine is just a single. But the chickadees love to go in here and pick. And I got to fill out every other day. I do have a lot of chickadees, but they're always in and out, flitting around black oil sunflower seeds. That one, Elkmont seed. Yep. And Menards has them also. I saw them there yesterday, because I'm always checking their feed. Thistle feeder. Good. You can spend $2.98 or you can spend $40. You want to get somewhere in between there. You don't want that $2.98 one that's two piece. Make sure your plastic is one piece. You get two piece one, the first rainstorm, you look and there's a line of wet seed all the way down. Okay? Metal birches, these actually have plastic covers on them, but if you have squirrels, they chew them off right away anyway. But, pardon? Yeah, this one has got, this is strictly thistle feed. This is the little tiny one for thistle. One of my favorite, and I use a lot of these, is the Stokes. Don and Lillian Stokes are quite outstanding birders. They've written books and so forth, and their feeders are good feeders. They're easy. One of the things about a feeder you want is one that's easily to take apart. And this one is just a screw. You just slide out, slides off, everything's off, and you run a brush right through it. Plus, these are all metal. And this is a thistle feeder that has three openings there for the thistle. And they have the same thing that you can put your black oil in, or you can put a mixture in if you want. This is a neat little one. Another one that the chickadees really like. I don't know why, but I have to fill this one. Well, at the same time, I fill that square one over there. It's what they used to call satellite feeders. I don't know if there's a name for them now or not, but it's relatively inexpensive, but it's very good as far as black oil sunflower is concerned. To me, the jury's still out on this one. Black oil sunflower. Any of you use it? Have luck with it?
I shouldn't say don't have luck with it, but it's a damn messy because I hate seeing bird feed on the ground, but squirrels feed off the ground, but I just...
Yeah, this one would be, they've got all kinds, they've got two or three, they've got some that look like snowmen, they got all kinds of things with this water. This is one that has become very popular. This one, not for me. That's for thistle seed. First rain, it is totally wet, you've got to empty it off, wash it, clean it, dry it, put this in, and it rains the next day, you do the same thing over again. Okay, they do use it, the goldfinches love it, but it's not, to me, a practical one. Peanuts, I've got three of these out with peanuts in it. Matter of fact, this is the one I took off on my feeders because I couldn't find another new one. I got these at Mills, at Mills Fleet Farm Fleet. That's where I found these. It's the only place I found them with the bigger holdings for peanuts. Okay. So much of it for feeders. There's different kinds you can take a look at. Kind of conscious of time right now. Just a word about houses. If you have an area that you can draw birds in for our cavity nesters, I did bring one of the types of the bluebird houses that we make at Beaver Creek. Matter of fact, we've got, I made over 1,500 of them since we started. Because we do have the Eau Claire Bluebird Restoration Trail, if you're familiar with that. Go online, Eau Claire Bluebird Restoration. And if you have a bluebird trail or would like to get registered with it, you can go online, report. We'd like to have you report what you're finding in your bluebirds. This is a very simple house. When you make 1,500 of them, if you want something, very simple, easy to look at, easy to check, easy to clean. And if you've got a table saw, that's all we need, and the drill press, you're all set. Yes, sir.
I have bluebird houses out. I got a dozen of them now to put out. But I have problems with the flying squirrels eating the hole up.
Okay.
I went to a metal applicator. I got this idea on a bluebird house out on 93 there by the coffee shop.
Yep.
Okay, they got a 2.5-inch square stainless steel.
Yep.
And I had a guy make me a dozen of them and then drill four holes in them. And I'm putting them over the hole so the flying squirrels and them little chipmunks, they'll eat that hole out so they can crawl in there in the wintertime.
We actually, for the number of houses we have, I make those blocks, two-inch block, drill a hole in, two screws, and put it right over.
Yep.
And you got to replace them. Matter of fact, I got to go up to Hickory Hills and do that. We have about 40 houses out of Hickory Hills right now on our bluebird trail out there.
Yep.
25, I guess, up there. And we've got to go out and take a golf cart as soon as we get out and go around and check all those. But that's a simple one. Oh, and as far as bombing it, this is something DNR, Wisconsin DNR came up with. Half-inch conduit, and then there's a piece of half-inch rebar inside of it.
Okay.
You take the rebar, drive it in 2.5 feet from the ground, slip your half-inch conduit right over it. And what you can do is buy the 10-foot pieces, 5.5, and it becomes, again, watch when our puts it on sale. As I say, we put out, I know over 1,500 of these for the reserve, with scout troops, school groups, and so forth. I've got 6 workshops coming up now in the next few days, building bluebird houses. So. But good ones.
May I ask, what conditions do we need to attract bluebirds? I understand that they're a little particular.
Well, that's a good question. Interesting. How do you draw bluebirds? You don't just put a house up and you're going to have a bluebird tomorrow. I live down on South Michigan Street, off Ferry Street. and we get bluebirds there. Shouldn't. I mean, we don't have a wide open golf course-like property. But they will come in, you know, after a period of time, but we've got them coming there. You want an open area, fairly open area for bluebirds. You know, size of this room.
With no trees.
Well, you want trees within 20 to 25 yards of the house, because bluebirds are sight feeders. By that, they go to a perch area and look over the grasses, because they're sight feeders for bugs. So, like out at the golf course, where we've got it's ideal for them. It's interesting, we've produced several hundred bluebirds since we've been out there, and the golfers are saying, you know, the bugs are really down since you put those bluebird houses up. So the owner out there is extremely pleased and very, very helpful with our program and kids. As a matter of fact, we're going to have, last year, 2 years ago, we had a live camera on one of the houses. I mean, the Coral Eagles have nothing on us. We did that before they got on here. And we actually had a live camera on a bluebird house that beamed the activities right into the public. So this year, my gal is fired up on us to get 3 or 4 things like that. Yes, sir?
The problem with bluebirds, people put them too high.
5 feet.
That's all.
Five to 7 feet is...
5 feet is good.
5 feet to the hole?
Yeah. Yeah. See, now that conduit is 5 feet. So it basically, when this goes in, probably 5 feet will come here. One thing you want is where you can easily check it. Because if you're going to put a bluebird house, don't just put a house out, leave it, and check it in the fall and clean it out. You want to check it periodically to see what's going on. And you can check, once they start laying eggs, you can check that regularly, not every hour, but every couple of days, and it's not going to bother the bluebirds at all. Matter of fact, when we go out to check at the golf course, with the golf cart, they'll hear us coming, they'll come out, we'll take a look, close it back up, write down our notes, and before we get the golf cart going, she's back in. Yeah?
Yeah, Larry, as I've told you, I have a problem. I've got a few bluebird houses, but I've got wrens that love to come in at about the same time. And, you know, they'll even fight at the right sit on the house itself, to see who can get inside, and that Wren is a crusty little fellow.
Wrens are cute little birds, but they also will pick bluebird eggs and throw them out. So yeah, and part of the problem, I've actually had 4 types of birds nest in my yard at the same time. A bluebird, a tree swallow, a wren, and a chickadee, all within sight of each other. So if they are compatible, probably you won't get 2 wrens. Or will you get 2 chickadees, or maybe not even 2 bluebirds, but 4 species of birds all within sight of each other around the garden?
Which bird comes first? The bluebird?
Bluebirds will be back in the first part of March.
Uh-huh. Now, I've had bluebirds, but they didn't build nests, but they don't stay.
Don't have an answer. Don't have an answer, you know.
When they're getting a rebar in the ground, you have to do it.
Yeah. Although it's pretty easy to drive it in, even the way the frost is this year, I don't think there'd be any problem driving in. Now, I've only touched on some of this. Do you want to see a few birds for ID?
Yeah.
What did we say, 5 o'clock? You've done this before. Yeah, she's fired. Oh, I've heard those excuses before. Thank you for coming.
Are you
going to,
this is again tonight? For the
yes, yeah. Okay. And I don't know what I'm going to do yet tonight. We'll try to figure out something.
Well, you're doing some slideshow tonight.
I don't know. I don't have any notes. Okay, let's see. I'm going to, maybe I'll just get down the wall here. Slide that all day.
We just mentioned that if people do need to leave early, if you don't mind filling out your evaluation form and leaving the yellow sheet and leaving it at the back, that would be greatly appreciated.
Do these turn off?
Yep.
Okay. Yep. All right, I think we're ready to go. I'll sit right there. This is just some bird ID things. We'll go through them fast. There's, I don't know how many bird species we got here. Obviously, probably, you wonder, how did we get all these birds in hand? This is part of our program on Beaver Creek Reserve, where we've been able to photograph birds that we are banding. So here's the black-capped chickadee. Obviously, the goldfinch, and I always get the question, you know, people say, well, I have all those beautiful wild canaries all summer, and now all winter I got those funny green birds. What are they? Same bird. Now here's one in early spring, is already starting to pick. This is a male picking up his epidote colors here, but they're all pretty much like this in the winter months. Beautiful pattern as far, and there's one that again is in the molting stage. New feathers coming in. This is the American goldfinch. Obviously, this is my hedge outside my yard, outside my garage. And the blue jay. The American robin, which people were, I was on the Judy Clark program a few weeks ago, and Mark Ollie said, for goodness sakes, tell them just because the robins are here, it's not spring weather yet. You have been getting calls every day about, is spring here, Mark? Because the robins are back. And there were robins that had stayed all year. Now there's an in-ground bird bath. Notice how the robins enjoy it? He is really splashing in that. That was just something I had in the backyard. Not one of my favorite birds, but nevertheless, it's one that we have, which is the common grackle. There's one of them that was in my garden, in the backyard right there downtown. There's Dad Bluebird, and there's his partner ready to feed. Notice that fancy house? Yeah. Now, there's what we're talking about the guard. There's actually a fly on the other picture shows it better. Just a guard that was on there to cover the hole and then picked up. The red-winged blackbird, one of our first ones back. Neat bird, morning dove. I was on a first name basis with this guy in my garden. He'd come in and chatter. On the bee wall, yep. However, they do like the clear. And remember, the clear is good. Don't put red dye in. There's another. This was up at Blue Hill Summer Club. There's the other one that was in the garden. Common house wren. As soon as you're in, get the oranges and the grape jelly off. There's his partner. There's one that we don't appreciate when we're banding. The reason being, that beak is designed for cracking nuts. And you get a hold of one of them, they love to go right between the thumb and the first finger in that real soft flesh. I've seen grown men with tears in their eyes, but they are a beautiful bird. There she is, right at it. Great cat bird. What's this one? Tufted titmouse. Boy, they're active right now. These are the ones I like to talk to in the yard. You can talk to them forever. They'll follow you all over if you start imitating their sound. Doesn't have to have a fancy feeder. That's one that I have sentimental value over. My father, who's been gone for a long time, used to take mayonnaise jars, put a band around them, take the cover, put this on, fed an awful lot of birds out of that mayonnaise jar. What do we got? Nope, no purples. Summertime should tell. This is a summer picture, so it will tell us that it's not purple. These are the house finches. And the house finch is a kind of a brick red, where the purple finch is more of a grape. Downy or hairy?
Oh, I don't know. One or the other.
One or the other.
Downy.
Downy or hairy? Good bill. Less than half the width of the head. coloration the same, we're going to build on this one.
Oh, is that how you tell?
That's my easiest way. The downy is actually a little smaller than the hairy, but seeing them separately, I have a difficult time. So you look to the bill. If the bill is oversized, you got a hairy, red on the head, obviously it's male. No, not a woodpecker.
Another woodpecker,
the red-bellied woodpecker. Some people call it a ladderback, although the ladderback is a southwestern bird. This is a bird that we have right here, the red-bellied. Someone asked me before we started, why do you call it red-bellied? You have to be a bird bander to find out. You get it in his hand and you look between the legs, and there are some rusty red feathers right here. That's the only place that the red-bellied woodpecker has any red belly, is right there. Red Ed, the only one we've ever banded in Beaver Creek. That's right outside my kitchen window. Now there's one suet feeder. This one is actually a log. This one just plain suet pounded into it. There's one of my jar feeders. Pilly eggs tell the difference. If it's got a red mustache right there, it's the male. And if the red comes all the way down to the bill, it's a male. We caught two of them in the net at my house the other day at the same time and banded both of them. White-breasted nuthatch, got somebody. This little guy I like, one of my favorites. Red-breasted nuthatch. What is it? Bird that goes to the base of a tree, works its way upward, taking lichen and larva from underneath the bark, working up the tree. Brown creeper. There, somebody said that earlier. Yellow-bellied sapler. Not a good photo, it's the best I got. Confused sometimes with this guy. This is the northern flicker. And I've had one at my feeder all winter. Yeah, he stayed all winter. He's lived on suet. But the other day he did come up to the chips by the window and he was eating sunflower chips.
They usually go south, though, don't they?
Yeah. They're a migrating bird. But this one decided to eat some stuff at all. One of my favorite songbirds, which is the brown thrasher.
Yeah. I have one of
the most beautiful songbirds we have. Always sings in paired notes. Eastern towhee. Drink your tea. This is one you probably won't see at your feeder. And surprisingly, we got it in the net because it's a high canopy bird, the red-eyed vireo. Another one you don't necessarily see at a feeder, but he had to come down to the nest one day. The great crested flycatcher. He has the weep sound, the one call weep. Okay. Eastern Phoebe. The pale bobber. Cedar waxwings. Three swallows. This was the other one that was in my yard with the other bird. The killdeer because of the bars right here. There's the guy that likes to come around the yard. Cooper's Hawk. And that's one of my feeders. There's another picture of him eyeing up the feeder a little better. There's a sharp shin. Very similar. The male sharp shin, or I should say the female sharp shin and the male coopers are about the same size, same color. You know in the raptor family, the females are always larger than the males. So this little guy, this is the sharp shin. The female sharp, the male coopers are about the same size, and the coloration is almost the same. One has a squared tail, one has a rounded tail. Not one of my favorite birds. That is the
brown-headed
cowbird, who takes care of the nests of chipping sparrows. It parasitizes these nests terribly. What the cowbird does is take an egg out of the nest, lay one of their own, and leave. They do not build a nest. So the little chipping sparrow ends up trying to feed the great big cowbird. Song sparrow should be back before too long, about the time the bluebirds get back. The common yellow throat, or very common warblers that goes through. The most yellow bird we've got, this doesn't show in real well, but it's the yellow warbler. One that's sweet, so sweet, so sweet is his song. Bird that builds a nest like a Dutch oven, consequently called the oven bird. One that you often will find flying in the windows, and I don't know why, they have a high mortality rate with windows. This tells you what, this is a female of another species, the male, which is extremely colorful. You all know what this one is. Indigo bunny? There's Mrs. Bunny. A little bit of coloration, that's her extent. There's the male indigo. Like I said, this is the last one I've got. One quick scroll, man, set the trees. Indigo bunny is an interesting bird. We don't band a lot of them in the reserve, but in May of 1993, we caught an indigo bunny in the net. Now, these birds winter in South America, Central America, Central and South America. May of 93, we caught this bird out of the reserve. It was 2 years old by plumage. We knew it was at least a two-year-old bird, so it had been to South America once, or Central America once. May of 99, we caught the same bird. Which means, about a foot from where we had originally caught it. Which means he had now made 7 trips to Central America and came right back to the same location. Now, was he there every year? He may have been going back 1 day a week. But we know that bird was 7 or 8 years old. And our naturalist used to get a kick out because he said, we have people following Eau Claire, they're lost halfway to do the trick. This bird went to Central America 7 times and found his way back. Thank you, folks. My time is gone, and if you got